So ladies and gentlemen, get comfortable as I have the opportunity to talk to you and begin my process of defining the level of urgency needed as we talk about the aspect of our Kids Strong Conference. When we're talking about our most precious entity in our state, our 280,000 young people, we have to keep their voices alive in all that we do. So let me say to you, as we begin this conversation and journey, in order to teach a child well, you must know a child well. Let me say that again, and if you walk away with nothing else from these next several days, I want you to walk away with that one thought. And I want you to reflect on that thought and what it means. In order to teach a child well, you must know a child well. And if you're about children, they will know. They will know by your actions and the way you conduct yourself if you're about children. But my life is I've made a chosen point as a purpose-driven life to make a difference in the lives of children. And I bear with you today my heart and soul so that you know me better as a person. As your state superintendent, I'm driven by one uncompromising purpose: to make a difference in the lives of children. Because in this day and age, we can't just focus in on the curriculum and the content and the pedagogy. It's important. And it drives academic achievement. But if we haven't recognized now more than ever the importance of taking care of the whole child in what we do, the aspect of academic achievement is not maximized. So no one cares what you know until they know you care. You heard that before? No one cares what you know until they know you care. In order to teach a child well, you must know a child well. What if I told you I was that child? Would you believe it? The reality is, that's my story. And to whom much is given, much is expected. My life has been dedicated to serving children because during those darkest days of my upbringing, there were adults in my life who cared about me. It wasn't the ones who taught me the quadratic equation. It wasn't the ones who taught me the periodic table of elements. But it were the ones who said, "Hey, Mike, how you doing? How are your struggles? Looks like you're hungry. Did you eat? Here's an apple for you out of my lunch, because I know what you're going through." Connecting with the heart. Those are the people that I'm naturally attracted to. And so all the work that we do every day, there's a fight that's going on. A fight for children, where schools need to be viewed as places of hope and opportunity, not places where they are barriers. All children can and will learn and need to feel as if they can. Not because they come of poverty and those children are relegated to the sideline. Or young people who are from a different race or culture and they're pushed to the sideline. See, in West Virginia, we care about our children. We care about the importance of making a difference in the lives of our young people. And all children matter. If you have a belief that all children, if you believe all children can and will learn, those are the individuals I want in my life. So when we talk about the whole child, how do we educate any other way? There is no question that we've got a very clear vision for our state. There is no question that we have articulated that in a very clear manner across this state. One voice, one focus, all students achieving. And notice the operative words in that statement. What is the most operative word in that statement? All. When you have that value system and you say all, that means we mean all. Not just some, but all. All students achieving. And through intensive work and research, where we are now in the 21st century as educators, we know what works. And in a clearly delineated 10 points of priority under four pillars, I want you to intimately get involved with those pillars. We've delineated 10 clear focused issues that need to be tended to. Not in isolation, but simultaneously. So my conviction is based upon the fact that I want every young person in West Virginia graduating from high school, college, and career ready. Individual said to me, Dr. Martirano, you're introducing a very commonsensical back-to-basics plan for education. When did it ever go to vogue? When did we not want kids graduating from high school? When did we say it was okay for some kids to drop out of school? Where did we ever say that it's okay for kids not to attend school? You know, I come again from a background that says no matter what your chosen lot is in life, work hard every day, show up, and great things will happen. So attendance matters. Those of you with that responsibility, attendance matters. I need my babies in school every day. And we need to ensure that what's occurring in our schools is providing the supports necessary for the maturation and development process for our children. The whole child being connected to the educational process. Learning is a lifelong process. It's a 365-day event. It's not just relegated to 180 days. Those of you who understand the psychology of learning know it never stops. And you also know the fact that if you do the math, young people today from pre-K through 12 spend 9% of their time in school. Think about that, what I just said. From grades pre-K through 12, they only spend 9% of their time actually in schoolhouses. The rest of their time is spent with families, on weekends, in summer, at home, in communities, and churches. But what are we expected to do? 100% of the work in 9% of the time. So now the expectation of structural leadership, but safe and orderly environment. So here's how I've shifted. I've shifted to say, first and foremost, we have to have safe, orderly environments before we can have quality instructional programs occurring in schools. We have to tend to all the skills, soft skills, hard skills, however you want to define them, that support the overall child, the whole child. And train to do this. Stand at the door, and those 2,400 kids coming in, my goal was that they would have first contact would be with me as the principal. And my eye contact was right there with them. I would be looking and scanning and saying, this one's agitated, grab him, pull him over here. Get this one over here, something's going on, this one's crying, there's a girl fight going on over here, get him now, because I know that if I don't, what's going to happen? Drama, drama, chase another llama, we know that. We're going to be there all day. So grab it and diffuse. This is the reality of our kids. And we can't ignore that. Kids who've not been tended to medically, who have dental issues, who have health issues, and then we expect them all to learn. You know, we talk a lot about IQ, intelligent quotient. But I want to remind us about the importance of the other quotient, which is what I define as the EQ, the emotional quotient. And we need to take care of the emotional quotient every day in terms of the social-emotional learning that's occurring in our schools. And providing tools to our children in ways that advance that. So any programs that we're putting in place to create healthy choices, problem-solving, that diffuses problems, reduction of bullying, how to treat children, how to treat each other, how to work interpersonally together. Because in this day and age, if we can't work together and take care of each other, what's left? What's left? I mean, I have such resolve in the fact of the human condition in terms of it being good. If you are about kids, they will know. They will know. You don't have, I don't have to tell you that I'm about kids. Today I'm telling you about I'm about kids. But if we're interacting with kids, you just know. So where I started, symbolically, in order to teach a child well, you must know a child well. I end with the same message. In order to teach a child well, you must know a child well.